Hello students, in today's session we will discuss a frame analysis under the MDM method. In the MDM method, we have solved first of all the types of beams, beams with the fixed ends, beams with the hinge and fixed end, beams with the simple supports and overhangs. Now we are moving towards the B part of your unit, in which we trying to analyze or we trying to apply the moment distribution method for analysis of rigid frames. Okay, so in today's session we will analyze one rigid frame which is non-sway. In the beams you have a different support conditions, and accordingly your analysis process changes. But in the frames you have only two types, one is the sway frame and other one is the non-sway frame. Non-sway frame is the frame without joint translation, where the delta is will not be a unknown. Whereas if I said my joint translation is applicable, it means that along with your all the moments, you have to take care of the extra sway taking place and the deflection occurring because of it, right? So yes, we are today solving the frame with no joint translation or without joint translation, and in next few classes we will discuss the frames with the joint translation. How to apply the moment distribution method to such a frames we will understand later. In today's class we will focus upon the frame analysis without joint translation, right? So yes, let's read the question. Question says, analyze the frame as shown in the figure by moment distribution method. Okay, the frame given is, first of all, sometimes they will tell you analyze the given sway frame, analyze the given non-sway frame, but most of the time the university question papers or the MCQs which they develops, they always ask you to identify which type of frame it is. The very first task in solving the or in analyzing the frame is identifying it, is it a non-sway or sway frame. I have given a very brief description about it in the previous classes, that you have to check the symmetry into all respects. Is the given eye is symmetrical in the beam? If the ends are fixed, is there any cause which causing my structure to sway from its position, right? So given frame is a non-sway type of a frame. As we know, the joint translation, we are solving the frames without joint translation. That's why you can even without seeing the frame, you will understand that yes, there is no joint translation. Joint translation takes place with sway action, and that's why if there is no joint translation, there will not be a sway action taking place in our frame. Right, so we are solving the non-sway type of a frame given in the figure here. It is given like this, and it has a symmetry in the span, but or a frame is symmetrically formed, but eye is changing. Eye for the first two spans are same, but it is changing in the fourth span, I can say, or the third span, sorry. It is for span CD, it is 4/3i, which is making my frame unsymmetrical, but still I am saying that the frame is non-sway, because see, there is no force which causing my structure to sway down. There are many other parameters which you have to consider while checking the sway and non-sway action of your frames. Okay, I hope you have watched that lecture. And in today's class, instead of focusing how to identify the frames, we will focus that if the given frame is a non-sway type, how to apply the moment distribution. The agenda or the main purpose of this lecture is to make you understand that how to apply a moment distribution method to non-sway type of a frame, right? So we understood that there is a frame which is of non-sway type. The very first step I have shown here is fixed end movements. No matter you are solving beams or a frame, you are applying slope deflection method or the MDM method, irrespective of all, the very first step remains constant, which is calculation of fixed end movements. Even if you are applying or approaching with the slope deflection method or with the moment distribution method, you are always asked to calculate the fixed end movements in the very first step of your analysis, right? So here the fixed end movements, you can see in the given frame on span AB and on span CD, there is no external loading upon it, and that's why the moment, fixed end moments for the span A to B and C to D will remain zero, right? So moment, fixed end moment for span MFAB equals to zero, and for span MFBA is equals to zero. Whereas if I look at this span BC, it has a concentrated load of a 60 kilonewton, and this concentrated load of a 60 kilonewton will be giving us a fixed-end moment at span in this span at joint B and C, right? So fixed-end moment at joint B will be, or for span BC will be equals to WL by 8, whereas fixed-end moments for span CB will be minus WL by 8, right? So this is what the fixed end moment, here I have wrote W, it is not W, it is fixed end moment. Okay, so fixed end moment for span BC and span CB are given here, and I have given a standard formula with what type of a sign convention it comes. Okay, we have very habitual to it. I hope there is no need of very deep description. If we have this formulas in our mind, this is a very easiest step of your analysis, right? Yes, to put the values of W is 60, length is 2 plus 2, 4 meter divided by 8. So 60 into 4 divided by 8, giving me a fixed end moment at that span is equals to 30 kilonewton plus and minus, right? For span BC it is plus, for span CB it is minus MF. Okay. Then for the next span, again a moment becomes zero because there is no external loading acting upon my B. Right. Once you calculate the fixed end moments, the very next task is to calculate the distribution factor. Okay. So when you calculating distribution factor for the beams, we have applied one method where I have wrote a K value as I by L. I have wrote a K value as I by L, or a stiffness factor is written by the formula I by L. But if I here you can see, here I have applied something else. So there are two approaches, different books use different approaches. Out of that, a very frequently used approaches is one people use I by L as a K stiffness factor, whereas some people use 4EI by L as a stiffness factor. And how to use it, I'm to know you the both of the approach, I have choose this frame with the second method or a second approach, in which, look at here, if I have a beam like this, which is fixed end, one simple support, two simple supports in between, and then you have a hinge or a simple support at the end. Okay, in this beam, if I take a approach 2, then what it says, if your far end is fixed, then the value of K will be 4EI by L. If you are talking about the intermediate supports, the value of K will be 4EI by L. But if you are looking at the far end, exterior end, which is hinged, then the value changes to 3EI by L. Very similarly, how we did into the earlier method or the very first approach which we had learned, that is, again I am taking a same beam in which you have a hinge support at one end and the fixed at other. In this, if I apply a first method in which I said K is I by L, then K will be I by L for fixed end, it is I by L. For intermediate support, it is I by L. But for exterior hinge support, it changes to what? 3 by 4 I by L. Okay. And here, E is always there with it. But as E is remain constant, we take it, we have not put it here. Okay. But E is silent here. It is always there. We have assumed that in the mind that yes, E is coming with the I. But I changes, right? I changes from span to span, so we have paid attention. Much of the people pays attention to I but forgets about the E, so do not do that. Please keep in mind, even if you are writing I by L or 3/4 of I by L, still it is E comes with it. Okay, so we have two approaches. Either you can write a stiffness K value into the term of I by L ratio, or you can go with the 4 EI by L and 3 EI by L method. Okay, so here I have applied a 4 EI by L method, which tells that if this is my frame, okay, we are discussing frame. So this is my frame and it has a fixed end at its both ends, fixed support. And in this frame, for this span A, B, C and D. For span AB, the K factor is 4 EI by L, which is 1.33. Whereas the K value for this span BA, for span AB, let me check it again. Yes, in this frame for span AB, it is K is not present. We have not written. See, we have done this in the beams also. We have made a one rule, or you have to keep it in the mind that for joint A, we always write a K in a terms of joint. And when we write a K with respect to joint, you have to pay attention that at joint A, you only have one span on the either side of it. Okay, so there is no balancing span to it, and that's why we always consider such a span. We don't consider the K values for it, right? But at joint B, you have two spans, span BA and span BC. In this two of the spans, you have to write the K values. If I look towards the BA, the fixed end joint I come up with, and that's why the value of a K will become 4 EI by L. At span C, if you look at span BC from the joint B, then you can see the C is a rigid joint, and again my value for it begins 4 EI by L. Now at joint CB, if you look at CB, it will be 4 EI by L because intermediate but rigid support. And from CD, if you go for the K value, it will again a 4 EI by L because you come up with the fixed end. But what if I replace this fixed end with the hinge support? Okay, if I provide a hinge support at this end, then your CD span represent the K value with 3 EI by L. It represent K value with what? 3 EI by L. Okay, so I hope you have understood the difference. Once you calculate the K values, the next task is summation of K and calculating distribution factor. How do we calculate the distribution factor? Distribution factor is summation of K by, K by summation of K. Distribution factor is K by summation of K. Okay, once you calculate all these values, K, summation of K, distribution factor, your table gets complete, and now you go for the next table, which is a table of moment distribution method. Okay, or a moment distribution table, in which I have made I have chosen a problem with multiple iteration. Okay, I have chosen a problem with multiple iterations here because my moments are not getting balanced at joint B and C. I have not choose actually a problem come up with the multiple iterations because moments were not getting balanced. So how I did that iteration, have we performed the moment distribution method on the frames, we will understand that. Basically, you consider your frame as a beam, and here you have a fixed end at AB and here you have a fixed end at DC. Then intermediate spans are written as we wrote for the, as we did for the slope deflection method. There also we have drawn a frame as a beam and we have analyzed it. Right. Now here also we are doing same. We are analyzing the frame as a beam where we have a fixed end as well as we have shown an intermediate supports like. Then you have distribution factor here. 0.57 and 0.43, 0.43 and 0.57, which we have already calculated in the distribution factor table, right? Next you have is a performing the iterations. First you have to write in the this fixed in moments which you have calculated in the step number 1. There you have calculated fixed in moments. Fixed in moments calculation is how you do that. In the fixed in moment, you can take a standard formulas, look at the external loading conditions, and you perform the calculations, right? It has a theory behind it. I hope you have remembered that. But yes, I am writing those finite element fixed in moments here. 0 for the first span, as there was no external loading acting upon it. In the next span BC, there was a load acting of 60 kilonewton intensity, and which creates the fixed end moments of 30 and minus 30. And in the next span CD, as well as there is no loading, there will not be a fixed end moments. That becomes the 0. Right. Next is a doing distribution moment. Calculating distribution moment, for that what you have to do is addition of this 2 and addition of this 2. Addition of 0 plus 30 will be 30, and change the multiply by that 30 with a distribution factor, and then change the sign and write it down below. So take your calci out, plus 30 into 0.57, plus 30 into 0.57, and change the sign. It gives you minus 17.10. Again, repeat the procedure. Plus 30 into 0.43. It gives you, and change the sign. It is plus 30 into 0.43. It will be a minus of 12.10. Similarly, in the next span or at next joint C, you have a distribution factor as 0.43 and 0.57. Do the summation of finite element moment at that joint. It is minus 30 and 0. So my final summation of fixed end moment at joint C will be minus 30. Minus 30 into 0.43. And change the sign. Minus 30 into 0.43 gives me a plus 12.9. Whereas minus 30 into 0.57 and change the sign and write it down, 10, it gives me 17.10. Okay. If you are watching this lecture, I request you stop here and come with your calci. Repeat the iterations along with me. Do the calculation along with me. If you don't understand, stop the lecture. Calculate it. Once you get, start your session again. Okay, that is how you can understand it. Right? Now, once you do this distribution of moment, you come up with these values, and now the time comes to carry forward this joint moments to the other span, right? And that's how the carryover moment comes into your table. Carryover moment from the 70, where to take a carryover moment? If you have intermediate spans, if you are dealing with the intermediate spans, the carryover moment always go into the half value, okay? Half of the moment will be taken as a carryover to the intermediate supports, right? If you have a fixed end come up with the moment, right? And therefore, from the intermediate support, you can take a moment to the fixed end, okay? But if you have a last end or exterior other end as a hinge support, then you cannot take the moment to the hinge support. But in our frame, AB, the joint A and also the joint D, both has a fixed ends. Therefore, from the intermediate support, you can take a carryover moment to the joint D. How I said, I'm repeating it one more time, that from the intermediate support there will be always a half carryover moment from BC span to CB and from CB span to BC. There will be always a carryover moment from fixed end to the intermediate end. There will be always a carryover moment from fixed end to intermediate end, but here the fixed end has itself a zero fixed moment. Therefore, here you cannot see a carryover moment in from fixed to intermediate, right? But from intermediate, you also takes a moment to the fixed end, right? So finally, the pattern of carryover factor will becomes like intermediate support get half from intermediate support to fixed end, from intermediate support to fixed end. So this pattern of carryover movement you have to follow through the each of iteration you are doing into your problem, right? Let's understand one more iteration, and you can continue those iteration at your home with the similar pattern. Here, once you calculate the carryover factors, carryover moments, here your first cycle ends. Sometimes people take fixed end moment, distribution moment and carryover moment as of one cycle. Some people take fixed end moment and distribution moment, that is one cycle. It is up to you, okay? But pattern and the type of iteration you are performing has to remain same. Once you get the carryover moment, once you get the carryover moment in this form here, then again you have to distribute it, distributory moments. Then here you have nothing, here you have no values. Addition of this two and multiplying it with the respective distribution factor and changing a sign and writing it downward, that is the next, that is how we can calculate the distribution moment for next iteration. Have I said? You come up with this carryover factor, you have a no value for span BA, for span BA. Addition of this two, it will give a positive 6.45, okay? Then multiply it with the respective distribution factor. Then next step is change the sign. Whatever intensity you got, 6.45 into 0.43 or 6.45 into 0.57, whatever intensity you get, you change the sign of it. If it is positive, you are both of the values in the distribution moment becomes negative. Similarly, perform the same task here. You have no value for span CD. Minus 6.45 is a summation of both of the moments at that joint, and multiply by minus 6.45 is a summation. Multiply that with the respective distribution factor, change the sign, and as it is minus, both of the distribution moments become positive, right? From there, again, you have to take a carryover moment. Carryover moment from intermediate support to fixed end, intermediate support to other intermediate support, and carryover to intermediate support to exterior fixed end, right? Accordingly, you perform the iterations here similarly. Here, once you done the carryover moment, these carryover moments will be added with the other joint moment, and those summation will again multiplied with your distribution factors. Similarly, here multiply those with the distribution factor, respective distribution factor, and those are the positive values. If it is positive, the signs will change to negative. If it is negative, signs will change to positive. That is how you done this third iteration. Check the carryover. While doing the carryover, your sign will remain same. If you have here negative, carryover will again come with the negative, half of that magnitude. But while doing the distribution moment, you have to change the sign. While taking the carryover moment, sign will remain same, magnitude will reduce to half. So perform the all iterations in the similar manner, and you will get a final moment here. Perform similarly. See, if carryover is negative, it will come with the negative sign. If carryover is positive, it will come with the positive sign. Only the reduction and the magnitude changes to half. Once you perform the iterations here, almost my moments are became zero. Carryover moments are became zero. Now, if I further do the moments are not there. It is already nullified to zero. At this stage, you can stop yourself and check that if the joint B, C, D and A moments, do the summation. Now what you are summing up for joint A, you are adding all the moments here. You are doing summation, okay? I am not saying addition. I am saying summation. If value comes negative, it will goes with negative. If value comes with positive, it will goes with positive. Do the summation. You, whatever sign comes with the magnitude will be a moment at that particular joint. What I say? Whatever sign with the magnitude comes will be the moment at that joint. So here you can see both of the joints come up with exactly same values of a magnitude as distribution moment was same, and even the fixed end moments were same. Distribution moments factor you can see 0.57, 0.43, 0.43, 0.57. As well as the fixed end moments were 30 and minus 30. Therefore, since the initial input which we have provided for the table is very symmetrical, you can see the values at C at the bottom which got balanced 21.79 and 21.79. Both B and C are showing us the same magnitude, right? These are the final moments at joint A, B, C and D. This is how we have applied a moment distribution method to fixed end rigid jointed frame analysis. Thank you so much.